everyone! Welcome to Thursday's Deception Diaries. My name's Robin, the cool one, and in today's episode, we'll be talking about the case of Charlie Ross. Who's Charlie Ross? I don't know. You and I are going to be learning about him today together. One of the most famous kidnapping cases in the United States. This is going to be fun. And the first kidnapping for ransom recorded in the United States. This case is the literal origin of the famous words parents tell their children, don't take candy from strangers. Oh, all right then, this should be fun. Get out your coffee, your energy drinks, your soda, your water, your tea. Sit down, maybe make some popcorn too, and join me, won't you? All right, I'm just doing some stretches. In late June of 1874, a buggy pulled up outside of the Ross Mansion, a large home in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, in Germantown, belonging to a wealthy family of nine. The man driving the buggy began speaking to two of the children that lived in the home, Charlie and Walter Ross. The man's face donned a reddish mustache and eyeglasses. He was accompanied by another man who was older than him. As the buggy stopped, the men began speaking to the two boys and offered them candy. Eventually, the men drove away and the two boys went back into the house, where Walter, who was six at the time, told his father, Christian Ross, that a man had pulled up and offered them candy. During this time period, there was a lot more trust in strangers and those around you, which is evident in their father's reaction. Ross simply believed that a man who was fond of children had offered his kids some candy and went on his way. Though, that alone does sound kind of creepy, definitely creepy enough to keep the children inside, Ross saw nothing wrong with it and continued along with his day. His guard was down, and so was the children's. This would soon be realized as an awful, terrible mistake. On July 1st, the boys approached their father and asked for money for firecrackers. According to Christian Ross's book, The Father's Story of Charlie Ross, on the morning of that day, the children asked me for money to buy firecrackers for the 4th of July. I told them I would get them some and be with them on the 4th, but I was afraid they would set fire to the house stable if alone. Their minds seemed set on having them at once, though, and to please them, I told them I would send home a cartload of seashore sand in which they could play on the 4th of July, and they could fire their crackers in it. In order to fulfill my promise to the children, I came to Germantown earlier than usual, bought the sand, and got home before 6 o'clock. When he returned home, the boys were nowhere to be seen. At first, their father thought nothing about it. He had asked the maid if she'd seen them, and she reported that they had been out front playing with some friends. After checking in front and not seeing them, Ross assumed that the boys had simply wandered off and were somewhere in the neighborhood. They would be back soon enough. But soon enough didn't come, and by tea time, Ross was beginning to worry. He sent his maids out to check for the boys at homes he thought they might have been at, and then he began searching himself. At this point, he was worried, but still believed that they couldn't have gone far and were likely still playing with friends somewhere. That is, until he began walking back to his home. A neighbor called out to him and asked him if the children would ever go with strangers somewhere. She reported that she had seen someone driving past them in a buggy with two men in it she'd never seen before. This set off alarm bells for Ross. He immediately left for the police station to try and contact the Central City office with a telegraph describing his situation. Accompanied by the neighbor's husband, the one who had told him about the boys, they were nearly there when they saw a man approaching them. Walking beside him was one of the boys, 6-year-old Walter. It was nearly 8 at night by this point. The man with Walter spoke for the boy because he was too frightened to speak. That man, Mr. Peacock, told Ross that he had found Walter wandering alone in Kensington, a northern district of Philadelphia. When Ross asked Walter where Charlie, his 4-year-old brother, was, Walter told him that his brother was still in the buggy with the men, confident that they would bring him back safely. Ross brought Walter back home and continued his search, being joined by his nephew. They stopped at the police station and informed the detective on duty at the time of what had happened. The detective told them that it sounded like a drunken frolic and that the men would return him soon enough. Well, thanks, that's really, really great, detective. That makes me feel so much better, huh? Ross, refusing this explanation, as he should, went out to look for himself. They searched Kensington, asked Mr. Peacock questions about Walter and if he'd seen Charlie, and eventually came up empty-handed. Around 3 in the morning, the men were forced to walk back home, a nearly 2-hour walk due to streetcars no longer running at the time. By the time Ross arrived home, it was 5 in the morning. He was sick and terrified, not able to sleep or eat. Around 7:30, Ross woke Walter up, who was still shaken from being lost, and took him to his uncle's home, where they would question Walter and reveal the infamous story of Charlie's kidnapping. According to Ross, in the father's story, it goes a little something like this. Two men driving on the lane in a buggy had given him and his brother Charlie candy on Saturday, June 27th, Monday, June 29th, Tuesday, June 30th, and Wednesday, July 1st. Charlie had asked them for a ride, and also whether or not they would be able to buy him firecrackers, which they promised to do. After driving to the top of the hill, they turned around and took them into the wagon. Walter asked them to go to the main street to get firecrackers. To this request, the men said, "No, we'll take you to Aunt Susie's," a fictitious person who keeps a store and will give you pocketfuls for 5 cents. He said Charlie was placed on the seat between the men, and he sat on the knee of the one who was not driving. He said the men talked to them as they drove along, but said more to Charlie than to him. They did not say much to each other. Only one time the man not driving showed his hat to the driver, remarking that it was worn out. That man also commented on the speed the man was driving, indicating for him to drive slower or faster when they went up or down a hill. Eventually, Charlie started crying as they had driven quite a ways already. Charlie asked for the men to take them home. The men told him that they would be there soon. During the drive, the men stopped twice and asked Walter to fill a bottle they had in the car up with water, which they topped off with liquor and drank. On an important note, the man not driving described himself as being a farmer owning quite a bit of land. Once in Kensington, the men pulled up outside a cigar store and gave Walter 25 cents for firecrackers and torpedoes that were displayed in the window. While Walter was inside purchasing the items, the men drove off with Charlie. When Walter went outside to find that he was abandoned, he began crying, which gathered a small crowd. Mr. Peacock was part of that crowd and was the only one who brought him home. Wow, a town full of great, nice, polite citizens. You know what, Mr. Peacock? I salute you. At this point, Walter described the men to his father. He said that the driver was medium-sized, around his father's size actually, which was 5'9". He was rather full and red in the face, with a reddish or sandy mustache. Notably, he wore glasses, a gold watch, a gold vest chain, and green sleeve buttons. The other man was older and taller as well as heavier than the driver. He had whiskers of a similar color to the driver, and more importantly, his nose was turned up and deformed in some way. This man also wore glasses with gold frames and 2 gold rings. The horse pulling the buggy was brown with white on its head, wearing an old harness. The wagon itself was dark with red stripes on the wheels and blue cloth on the inside. A rather notable description. After getting the details from Walter, Ross and his nephew went up to the central police station to give them an account of the incident and to see if anyone had any new information. The police by this point were still dismissing the event as a drunken accident and that the men would soon enough bring the boy back after they got over the embarrassment. Wow, your police are fantastic. Hopefully they're better these days. The detective they'd met with the previous night offered to go look around Kensington again. Wow, he's doing his job now. Wow. And that is exactly what they did. With the help of Mr. Peacock, who felt obligated at this point to help, and eventually several more police officers. They searched everywhere, asking wagon rentals, ferries, stables, and more if they knew of the men, Charlie, or the wagon or horse. They unfortunately turned up empty-handed. Turning to Walter, they had him lead the search party along the route they took until Walter was abandoned. Walter had an incredible memory of the events, being able to lead them along the route they took, a deliberately wacky one with various twists and turns to try and confuse the children. Didn't work, did it? Everything that Walter recounted was later verified by onlookers, store owners, and road workers. Walter had asked the men about buildings they had passed, allowing him to remember easily. However, all leads ended in disappointment, and they were left empty-handed and back at square one. On July 3rd, after days of searching, Ross put out the first of 2 inquiries to the public ledger about a missing child, offering an undisclosed reward. At this time, Ross's wife, accompanied by 2 of their children, was out of town due to an illness. To prevent her from finding out and worrying, he signed the advertisements as the detective on the case. He then put out the second inquiry with the same signature, this time offering a reward of $300. Which may seem pretty small, but you gotta remember, This is the late 1800s we're talking about. That $300 is nearing $8,000 of money today. On either July 3rd or July 4th, the date often differs between the father's account and the articles about the story, Ross received the first 23 poorly written ransom letters, the start of an unprecedented case of kidnapping for ransom. The first letter was addressed on July 3rd and was postmarked in Philadelphia. The letter terrified Ross, as well as it should. It also terrified the rest of the community. Again, I don't blame them. The letter was littered with spelling errors that may or may not have been intentional to throw them off the trail, much like the route they took to get to the store with Walter and Charlie. The letter read, after fixing the mistakes, of course, July 3rd, Mr. Ross, be not uneasy. Your son, Charlie Brewster, Ross, he all right. We have got him, and no powers on earth can deliver out our hand. You will have to pay us before you get him from us, and pay us a big cent too. If you put the cops hunting for him, you are only defeating your own end. We have got him fit so no living power can get him from us alive. Ooh, okay. If any approach is made to his hiding place, that is the signal for his instant annihilation. If you regard his life, put no one to search for him. Your money can fetch him out alive and no other existing powers. Don't deceive yourself and think the detectives can get him from us, for that one is impossible. You'll hear from us in a few days. I think we can stop for just a quick moment here and point out, they said that they would trigger his annihilation? I'd be terrified for many reasons, but getting this gross, misspelled, misshapen note from some crackhead that lives in town, saying they're going to annihilate my child? That is a whole different level of fear. Now, according to the Smithsonian, the second came a couple of days later, stating the ransom amount. This is the lever that moved the rock that hides him from you. $20,000, not $1 less. Impossible. Impossible. You cannot get him without it. The sum of $20,000 in 1874, by the way, is equivalent to about $400,000 today. The police struggled in the search, though they began to take it far more seriously after the first note arrived. The police department at the time in Philadelphia was only around 30 years old. The second letter indicated that Ross should correspond with the kidnappers through the Philadelphia Ledger. So that's what he did. On July 7th, Ross placed an advertisement in the Ledger stating that he was ready to negotiate. Ross began to correspond, and with each advertisement, he would receive a letter in response. The police had full control over the responses at this point. They were kept purposefully vague so that the kidnappers would be encouraged to continue sending letters, hoping that at some point, the men would slip up and reveal just a little too much. During this time, the public fully found out about Charlie's kidnapping. The correspondence in the newspaper and ransom. This led to private citizens searching for Charlie and coming up with new leads all the time. The police had followed each lead, but none, out of dozens, led to the discovery of Charlie. On July 22nd, the mayor announced that on behalf of a collection of private citizens, he was offering a reward of $20,000 for the arrest of the kidnappers. They finally got the ball rolling with the negotiation. According to the historical crime detective, on July 30th, the abductors instructed Ross to procure a valise and, after painting it white, to put $20,000 in small bills inside and take the train leaving at midnight for New York. He was instructed to stand on the rear platform of the last car. This train was due to arrive in New York about 1 hour after sunrise. He was cautioned to be on the alert from the moment the train left the depot, and if he saw a torch and a white flag waved at nighttime near the track, or a white flag alone in the daytime, he should throw the valise instantly. If it was found to contain the money demanded, the child would be restored to its home within 10 hours. The white paint on the valise was so that it could be easily seen on a dark night. Ross brought the white painted valise to the location, but instead of the money, it held a note stating that the exchange needed to happen at the same time instead of the child being delivered later. However, that valise wasn't delivered because the signal was never given and the kidnappers never showed. Apparently, a newspaper article had reported that Ross had gone in the wrong direction to deliver the money, which was not true, but the kidnappers apparently believed it, and later sent a letter chiding him for going the wrong way. They went back and forth, but ultimately the kidnappers refused to give the child at the same time as the money. On August 2nd, a chief of police from New York asked for the letter stating that he had good information and that he might know who the kidnappers are. Upon receiving the letters, the handwriting was identified by an informant to be that of William Mosher. William Mosher, along with his friend Joseph Douglas, who had been living at Monroe Street in Philadelphia along with Mosher's wife at the time of Charlie's kidnapping. Mosher was a fugitive, having escaped jail in 1871 and using the alias Johnson ever since. They had a horse and a wagon, but the stable where they housed them had been torn down, and the horse and wagon disappeared around the time that Charlie was kidnapped. The informant had told the police that the two men had asked him to assist in the kidnapping of one of the Vanderbilt children and wanted to hold him for ransom. The informant had refused and gone to the police. They now suspected that the men were responsible for the kidnapping of Charlie because the second kidnapping proposed to the informant was an uncommon occurrence at the time and a little too coincidental. They also suspected the men because the informant described unique physical characteristics of said men that Walter had described to the police, which the police had kept from the public. They believed that they had figured out who Charlie's kidnappers were, but naturally, they didn't have a clue as to where they could be. The police searched to no avail. Ross was still in constant contact with the kidnappers, but not much was coming out of the communication. The final letter, number 23, on the 7th of November, indicated that the man had been trying to kidnap another child for 3 months now, perhaps the Vanderbilt child, and that if they had succeeded, that Charlie would have already been dead. On November 15th, Ross and the police made their last effort to deliver the money, but this time to actually do so. Ross was instructed by the kidnappers to send two relatives to New York to stay in a hotel and that a man with no knowledge of the situation was to come pick up the money. The man would take a route afterwards that would be impossible to follow him through without being seen. They told Ross that if a man was followed, they would immediately kill the child. Ross had two family members go to a hotel and place an ad in the New York Herald telling the kidnappers where they were. The family members did exactly as instructed, but nobody came to claim the money. At this point, the family was just exhausted, and Mr. and Mrs. Ross were exhausted and mentally declining. This was the last attempt at communication made with the kidnappers. Now, on December 14th, two criminals were gunned down by a wealthy man and his two guards after they were caught breaking into the man's home in Long Island. The two criminals were William Mosher and Joseph Douglas. Both were mortally wounded, with Mosher dying instantly. Douglas lived just 2 hours more. According to the Pennsylvania Center for the Book, Douglas confessed just minutes before his death that they were the men who had stolen little Charlie Ross. "It's no use lying now. Mosher and I stole Charlie Ross from Germantown. God knows I tell you the truth. I don't know where he is. Only Mosher knew." Walter was brought in to identify the bodies, and he then confirmed that those were the men who had kidnapped Charlie, specifically noting Mosher's nose, which had been eaten away by cancer, and he could easily remember it. No one knew where Charlie was. The only men who knew were dead. Mosher's wife knew nothing, and his brother-in-law, who they found out had posted some of the ransom notes, also knew nothing about his whereabouts. In 1897, Christian Ross died, having spent almost every penny trying to find his son. Over the years, there were many men who came forward claiming that they were Charlie Ross. However, no one could prove it. In 1932, an article in the Philadelphia Record told the story of a man claiming to be Charlie Ross. The article stated that along with Mosher, Douglas, and Mosher's brother-in-law, there was a fourth man named John Hawk who was part of the scheme in 1874. John Hawk was 15 at the time. Hawk asked a former landlord to borrow his son for the summer to be a playmate for his sister's child. Instead of being a playmate, the landlord's son, Lincoln, was made to guard a 4-year-old child in a cave. The boy claimed to be Charlie Ross. By the fall, Lincoln returned home with Hawk and Charlie. Hawk claimed that his sister had died and that he needed to leave the boy in the Lincoln's family's care. The family grew suspicious that this boy was Charlie Ross, and then, over an argument about the child and the kidnapping, Lincoln's father killed Hawk and buried his body. They kept the event a secret out of fear of being roped in with the kidnapping and simply changed Charlie's name to Nelson after a child of theirs that had recently passed away. According to the article, Nelson later suspected that he wasn't related to them and fled to Canada, changing his name to Gustave Blair. Now, the Ross family dismissed Blair's claims, and in 1939, he sued Walter to be recognized as Charlie Ross. Eventually, because there was no one and no evidence to disprove his claims, an Arizona court declared Blair to legally be Charlie Ross. Walter went to his grave denying Blair's claims. and Blair went to his proclaiming them. Later, descendants of Blair reported that they wished to conduct a DNA test. Some sources, Merc Docs, claimed that the DNA tests falsified Blair's claims, though no official DNA test result has ever been reported. It's kind of making me curious. What's the big deal here? Despite these claims, in 1897, a son of a key informant to the police, a family member to Mosher, was told by his father that Charlie Ross had been killed. Supposedly, his body had been put into the wall of the Mosher's former abandoned restaurant in New York City. Apparently, when taking down the building, a workwoman had found a skeleton of a child in the wall. An article by Thomas Everly in the Pennsylvania History, a journal of the Mid-Atlantic Studies, which had been very helpful while studying this case, stated that the reason this news, given by key police informants, wasn't more widespread was because Mosher's wife claimed that she believed the boy was alive. There was so much hope that the idea of Charlie having been killed was put out of everyone's minds. Despite the horrors of the crime, some good did come out of it. The Charlie Project, a website dedicated to cataloging information about missing persons, was named for Charlie Ross. The website allows people to find information regarding missing persons in one place and acts as an amplifier on social media, oftentimes for those who have been missing and forgotten by the press. The kidnapping of Charlie Ross is one of the widest known abduction cases in United States history. The first kidnapping for ransom that has been recorded and sparks controversy and disagreement amongst the true crime community. Was Charlie killed, or had he been living among the family for years? We might never know. The case now acts as a reminder for parents to watch their children and a reminder for children to never take candy from strangers. Well, I'd say we certainly learned quite a bit today, didn't we? Folks, I want to thank you so much for coming out. I hope you enjoyed today's episode. Make sure to drop a like, a subscription, a follow, anywhere you can. And hey, if you liked my narration, why not check out my links in the description down below? And until next time, we'll catch you later, folks.